makes for a good sports car does not. Ladies and gentlemen, these are six reasons why you should not buy a Toyota GR86 or Subaru BRZ. Reason number one is that you love 0 to 60 times. You love acceleration. You're a spec sheet warrior. I'll tell you right off the bat, this car is not going to give you any kicks. The engine is no longer holding it back like it did so in the first generation. Now the engine is adequate. It's still not a strong suit, but it doesn't hold the car back. The money and development in this car went to building a front engine, rear wheel drive, driver's focused platform. So if you enjoy straight line acceleration, which I personally think is boring, you know, I've been in Teslas and they're really fun a few times and you're like, okay, that's it. You're not gonna enjoy this car. A car like this helps you improve as a driver. It may not be as fast around certain tracks as, let's say, a Civic Type R or a Elantra Type N, but a fast front-wheel drive car is never gonna allow you to advance in terms of your overall driving skills as a rear-wheel drive platform. You can't learn how to handle power oversteer in a front-wheel drive car, as an example. And learning how to control that safely and toe the line is a very important skill to have if you want to be a good, competent driver. For around the same price, you can get into a base-level muscle car, something like a Ford Mustang EcoBoost, Chevy Camaro, Dodge Challenger. But I would take this over every one of those cars because this is more dynamically engaging. Those cars may be faster in a straight line. They may have more power. But if you're looking for things like steering, transmission feel, driver enjoyment, they just don't compare, in my opinion. I've actually reviewed all three on this channel, and you can find links to those down in the description. Reason number two is that you need a lot of space. So this car is obviously a two-door sports car. It's a 2+2. The rear seats do fold back. And if you need to carry around a big dog, your whole family, your wife and a couple kids, it's not gonna be the car for you, obviously. At least not as a single vehicle. But I do wanna say that a lot of people, I don't wanna sell it short because a lot of people think that this car is impractical, which I don't think so. I owned a Scion FRS for over 9 years and I daily drove that, my only vehicle. And I was actually amazed by how practical it was. I used to call it my clown car because you had so many things you could fit in with the seats folded down. I could move between apartments, no problem. I could fit my bicycle back there. It's a shockingly practical car, more so than you would expect looking from the exterior. Fitting one other passenger, not a problem at all. You have enough space in the back for your bags and such. If you need to regularly carry more than one passenger or larger luggage and such, then okay, you might have a problem. Reason number three is that you care about track time bragging rights. There was a comment on my IS500 video where they were saying the Veloster N is much faster around the track, and therefore that's the superior vehicle to the IS500, which of course is a silly comparison to make. But if you are obsessed with lap times, this car is definitely not for you. If you care about what car is fastest around the Nürburgring or insert track name, this is really not your car. They purposely put low grip tires on this car. This car, this is the base level, which has the HP Primacy tires. And even the premium has the Michelin Pilot Sport 4s, not the 4S's, which are substantially grippier. They purposely make this car low grip because it's so easy to slide around. It's so playful. Now, that makes it not as good on track, but even though I go on track pretty regularly, I have usually 10 track days per year. The other 355 days, I'm not on track. So I want a car that's fun driving around public roads as well. Reason number four is that you're overly concerned about reliability. Now, this one is a little bit tongue-in-cheek because the cars are actually really reliable, but if you believe the internet, you'd think that every single car is blowing up because of RTV-induced oil starvation. I think the issue is way overblown. I talked with Zygreen, Fenton Sun from the Zygreen channel, as well as the Topher in this podcast episode up here, and we all agree, we all own BRZs or 86s, and we drive them hard, we track them. We think the issue is overblown and shouldn't be taken too seriously when considering whether or not to purchase this vehicle. Is it a risk? Yeah. Is it overblown? Also, yeah. The car's not going to be bulletproof like a Toyota Camry, but I did own the first gen FRS for 9 years, which also had some reliability issues here and there. Again, very small percentage of people. And I drove that thing hard, 83,000 miles, lots of track days, lots of autocross, and no issues. I was very careful, however, to make sure the engine was always up to temp before I pushed it hard. That's one thing that a lot of people don't do, even at track days. It's actually surprisingly uncommon. There are some respected experts on this platform, like the CSG team, and they also say that they've never seen any issues with the engine induced by RTV. They feel that the issues that we have seen with spun rod bearings and blown engines is more a function of oil thinning out from using the wrong oil, if you're tracking on 0W20 as an example versus 5W30, or from the engine oil getting too hot and not paying attention to your temps and it thins out. I've also done a handful of track days on this GR86, no issues, only mods were brake pads, fluids, and oil cooler for the engine, Jackson Racing. Reason number five is you want raw. Compared to the first gen FRS, this is a much better daily driver. The NVH is way improved. Less road noise, I mean, still noisy by modern standards, but substantially less. It's not painful now to drive on the highway. The suspension is much softer, more supple, better ride quality. But the steering is a big downgrade. Big, big downgrade from the first gen. I vastly prefer that. This steering is lighter, which may fit the character of a light, nimble sports car. But in every other way, the feedback, the loading, the weighting, first gen, I think, is superior. This may seem like a strange point to bring up, but you have to remember that oftentimes what makes for a good sports car does not make for a good daily driver. A good sports car gives you an experience, a rush, a thrill. It's not good as a daily because it's too exhausting, it's too loud, it's too harsh, but it gives you a memorable, fun, and engaging experience. And if you do crave that, this car might be too polished, too refined, too modern for you, and you may actually prefer either the first gen or another car that's even more raw, like the Honda S2000 or an older Mazda Miata. And the sixth and final point is that you demand luxury. Now, don't get me wrong, this interior and the fit and finish is head and shoulders above the first gen, but you still have occasional rattles. I have some up here. You still don't feel like this is as premium of a place if you're used to things like German luxury or even just premium vehicles like Acuras or even newer Mazdas. I have a new CX-50 and that interior is way, way nicer than this. I feel that it's perfectly adequate for a sports car, but I do have one friend who drives a 3 Series, and back in the day, he always told me that once he went to German luxury, it was so difficult for him to downgrade and go back to a car like this because it just felt too basic. And that's it, my friends. These are 6 reasons why you should not buy a GR86 or BRZ. If you have any additional ones, please add them with a comment down below. Much love, and I'll see you guys in the next one.